You are now listening to the Overflow Podcast at thisisoutcry.com. I'm not gonna say it.
Wow.
I'm just not. You have shamed me into not saying it. So hi everybody.
Praise Jesus.
This is this is Joaquin.
This is Jay. How did I shame you?
And this is the Overflow Podcast. That this is Outcry. This is gonna be my whole tone for the rest of the time.
Get out of here.
Hey.
Hey.
Hi guys.
You're gonna be Ross tonight.
Hey guys.
No, actually, if I was Ross.
Hi guys.
Whatever. We all know I'm Chandler.
You are not Chandler. If you're Chandler, then who am I?
You're Joey.
Oh, man, forget about it.
Yeah, you see, you're Joey. I mean, or Phoebe.
No. Your mom is Phoebe.
But what's up, peoples? What's up, listeners out there in listening land? This is Joaquin.
This is Jake.
And this is the Overflow Podcast at thisisoutcry.com.
Today.
And we are super duper 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 excited to be here today.
Word.
So, as always, what's up, Jay?
You getting a little sick there, man?
Man, I've always got the sniffles, man. I don't know what it is with me, man. I don't know if I'm sick physically or just sick mentally and it manifests itself physically, or if it's just all the above.
Nah, if it was that you're sick mentally and it manifests itself physically, then you'd be like that all day, every day.
I'd be in a nut house.
You are. It's called Home Depot Corporate.
This is not brought to you by Home Depot Corporate.
It sure as heck is it.
We ain't got that kind of money. Yo, man, what's up, Jay? What you been up to?
Oh, man, work, and mass work.
That's it? Work, and mass work?
Work, and mass work. I mean, what else?
I don't know. Aren't you a pastor?
Yeah.
How's that going?
Work, and mass work. It's all the same.
Is it really?
Work, and mass work. Well,
it's supposed to be your passion.
It is. It is my passion. That's why I'm not complaining about it. Pero,
is it?
You know, it's different when it's an established church and you got your building, you got your people, you got your whatever, right? Like, we're still building this thing. So,
right. Not building a building, just building people.
They're still.
We're making our own congregation.
There's still work.
Yes.
It's still, you know, it's still a lot of work, a lot of prayer, a lot of suffering, a lot of planning, a lot of strategizing, a lot of saying no, that won't work.
And usually that means that what Jay really means is a lot of me saying no,
dude,
and Jay going, come on, man.
There are a lot of things that I tell myself no that I don't even tell you because I already did. like I think about it and I come up with all these plans and I'm like no. If I bring it to you, it's because I kind of think it's a good idea.
And then it's my job to shoot it down.
And then you tell me, no. Yeah. Well, actually, you haven't been telling me no a lot lately. Lately, you've been telling me, I think you're trying to work on your negativity because your responses lately have been, how about we pocket that and come back to it later? It's like, okay,
no,
that's a no. That's like when dad tells you, go ask your mother.
Right, no, it's not that I'm being less negative. I'm just being negative in a just a quieter, sneakier way.
Jerk.
So yeah. So all right. So yeah, the church stuff is going good. All right. Well, that's cool. Yeah. You know, for me, it's been okay. I guess I had a lot of turmoil last week at work near the end. Actually, on Friday. And
yeah, your whole work life has shifted, hasn't it?
To an extent, you know, my leadership has changed, and so we're just kind of testing that out, seeing how it's gonna eventually rectify or blow itself up. There might be some opportunities for promotion though, because some guys are idiots and they can't recognize that when they're given a chance. You know, like when you give it a chance to to straighten out.
To an idiot. To an idiot.
You know, so. But other than that, man, I am about 4 pounds away from my first goal in this weight loss thing that I've been I've been working on. So that's been pretty good. Been a lot of soreness because my muscles are like, yo, bro, what are you doing? When I used to like all this work, man. It's been a long time since we've had to move in those directions.
Oh, you stupid.
But yeah, man, but that's it. We're just days away. Or not days. We're a week away. Tomorrow will be about a week. No, a week and 2 days. We're a week and 2 days.
Wow.
From the cruise. Yeah.
So that means that we're a week and 2 days from my birthday.
Well, actually, we're a week and 3 days from your birthday. But we're a week and 2 days from.
So a week and 2 days from leaving. The trip. Okay.
Yes. We're a week and 2 days from leaving. And then a week and 3 days from your, was it 50th birthday?
Sure. Let's do that.
Yeah. Jay's going to be 80 years old. So it's kind of cool.
Damn. Every day I get older and older.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll be dust by the time I'm done with this podcast.
Jerk.
So we got that. So anyway, so we got the cruise, the Jesus Freak cruise coming up, and I'm not as excited as I was a couple of weeks back.
Really?
Yeah, I'm just kind of like, oh, good here. You know, like I think when we get on the boat, then I'm gonna be excited.
I'm on a boat.
Yeah, I'll be like, I'm on a boat. So we got Lonely Island and Lonely Island.
Lonely Island.
That's the group that did the song that you should listen to.
Or you should not listen to.
You should listen. You can listen to it. Just listen to the edited version.
Or not.
Or, you know, do what you want. You might be a grown up. So a couple trailers dropped this week.
We had a few of them.
We had a few trailers drop. What's one that stood out to you?
All right. The one that I liked the most, right? Because there were a few. And not just comic book stuff, right? Because that's not all that we do. But the one that stood out the most, there were two.
Okay. What were they?
All right. The first one was The Foreigner.
The Jackie Chan and Pierce Brosnan movie. Yep.
Right? That
looks really good.
Phenomenal, right? It's weird because Jackie Chan isn't the happy go lucky character that he normally plays in his movies. Right. Well, in his American movies, right? Or his English movies, because he's done a lot of dramatic roles.
Even in his Chinese movies, very, very, very few.
Very few, but he's done more. He's done more Chinese roles, right? In Chinese movies where he plays a serious role, like Who Am I? Forget about it. Like it's like
you would consider that a serious role?
Yes. Who am I?
I don't know. Who are you, Jay?
Jerk. Anyway, The Foreigner, and then
I totally forgot about that.
And then Jumanji.
Jumanji came out. Yeah, that was the one that.
It looks really fun.
Yeah, it looks like a throwback to those kind of action adventure flicks. To me, the one that came to mind was like the original Mummy.
Right, with the Brendan Fraser.
Yeah, where it was just kind of fun and a lot of just fun action and good humor. So,
word.
You know, that was exciting. Now the interesting trailer for me though. Well, yes, those two, The Foreigner and Jumanji, hands down, I think the best trailers to come out this week. But then they released that trailer for Inhumans, for the Marvel Inhumans for TV show.
That didn't excite me as much.
It's not about being excited. It was interesting. I thought it was interesting that they released a trailer this early for that show. I think it's because they're going to...
Well, it's because they're going to show it.
IMAX.
Yeah, the IMAX way before it comes on TV.
So it's going
to
be like a...
We should try to get tickets for that.
Yeah, they're going
to
show the... Because they filmed it in the IMAX format. So that should be... I don't know. I thought it was interesting. I thought it was just an interesting... It looks interesting because I didn't really... Whatever. I was like, man, whatever. Another Marvel TV show. They haven't been as good as the DC shows. But when I saw the trailer, I was like, that's interesting. I might give it a shot to see what, if it, you know, if it pulls me in or if I'm just gonna.
You gonna what?
Like I did Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Just let it go.
Yeah, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Even though when they put up, when they introduced Ghost Rider,
right,
on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., like for those episodes, it was dope.
Well, it was getting good, but it was just taking so long for it to get good, and I just kind of lost steam with it.
No, I lost also, but then when,
because I saw the first few episodes with Ghost Rider and they were cool, but then they hit a break, you know, those weird breaks,
those weird breaks that
TV does now, and I lost all interest. Right now, I'm just waiting for and
Gotham to come back.
Don't judge me, but I'm waiting for Game of Thrones. I think comes out. Later this year.
Sinner.
So, yeah. Whatever. I'm waiting for Game, and then I'm waiting for The Badlands to come on Netflix so I can watch it.
The Badlands.
That was a good show on AMC.
That's right. The
Badlands. So if you like martial arts, check out Badlands on AMC. So what else do we have today, Jay? What else? What are the crazy
things? I forgot about The Badlands. Well, I need The Badlands to finish. Right, because I think season 2 is already out, right?
Yes. I don't know how many episodes. I'm thinking probably 13 episodes.
So I need them to finish so they can show up on Netflix so I can binge them.
That's what I just said.
No, you didn't.
Yeah.
No, you didn't. Lies.
Dang it, Jay. Get off your phone and listen to me.
It's funny how while we do the podcast, I design like a bunch of imagery for social media. Because if not, then I'll forget.
Right? How rude. How rude. As.
But what else?
As what's her name would say, from Family Matters.
Family Matters?
No, Family Matters. What's the name of the show?
Full House.
Full House. This is about family.
Full House. That show, the way it was made, would not be able to be made now.
There's a lot of those shows that in the 90s, right, that would not be made now.
If you were trying to make a show now of three single guys with two little girls, three little girls, yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, it would be, yeah.
And one of those guys, like a serial womanizer. Yeah. Whoa. That would not fly.
Well, not even, do you remember that show, My Two Dads?
No.
So there was a show, it came right around that time. It was a girl who
but it wasn't
like that. It was just a girl raised by her father, and the other guy was like her uncle or something, but it was like a dad or something. And
I never heard of that show.
Yeah, any show where a kid was being raised by two adult males would not fly.
Well,
especially if they're both straight.
Yeah, I was about to say, if one of them is gay, then yes, it'll be applauded and lauded as like groundbreaking, heroic.
No, not really. not anymore. Maybe in 99, maybe in 89 or 99 it would have, Jay. come join us in this century.
I refuse to live in a time where mumble rap is a thing.
Yeah, I'm not going to touch that. No.
That's a hit.
Well, that's like we were talking. Like I was watching Friends a few months back. I went on my yearly Friends binge, and I'm watching it, and I'm going, "Yeah, this show, that joke couldn't have been made today. That joke couldn't have been made today. That joke couldn't have been made." Basically, the whole show probably could not have been made today.
That happened to me too. I was watching it again. Also, one of my times. You know what? Let me just watch Friends because you know that the laughs are guaranteed.
Yeah.
And I was watching it with Junie actually, and I was like, yeah, this show would be completely different and not funny if it was made these days.
Right. It would be way more PC. Way more PC.
Yeah. Translation, not funny. But what other trailers what other trailers stood out to you?
What was it? It was Foreigner. Now, a trailer that made me go, I'm definitely not seeing that movie, was that Chucky trailer that we saw earlier. I was like, nope.
And people our age remember Chucky.
Yeah. Right? Nope. I didn't watch it.
Younger than us?
When it came out our age. Nope. Yeah, those kids with their silly horror movies.
Dude, yeah. There's no more horror movies. That doesn't exist in this time.
When I was a youth pastor at a Korean church, the kids would be like, come on, Joaquin, let's go see a movie. I'm like, what are you guys going to watch? And then, you know, The Grudge or like The Ring or whatever. And I'm like, nah, I'm good.
Yeah. Now, if it was like a Korean horror movie, yeah, that's just like, yeah, no, don't do that.
No, like no horror. Listen,
or a Japanese horror movie. That. Like when they recreate them, like The Ring, when they Americanize them, it's not as like terrifying as the original.
I was living in Texas. I was in Texas when I was teaching down there. And I went to these people's houses that I had met that I was going to church with. Like we're doing an outing or something. Mm-hmm. And so I get there and they're watching The Ring. And I walked in like halfway.
The American? Or Ringu?
I think it was The American. And it was halfway. I was kind of watching like halfway through it. Mm-hmm. I got there kind of halfway and I sat down. I'm like, oh, what are you guys watching? And I sit down and I just start watching it. And I'm watching it. And they're like, and I'm just like, you guys are watching this? And they're like, yeah. I'm like,
7 days.
Dude, and they're like, they go, oh no, you need to watch it from the beginning. I'm like, I am scared poopless right now. And it's daylight, the sunlight's coming through. Like, I am not gonna go watch this. I'm not gonna go watch this.
When that chick climbs out of the TV.
Oh my goodness. Oh, I was like, no. No, let me go home and watch Dumb and Dumber. I need to wipe this out of my mind. No.
Oh, that's hilarious. That's hilarious. That's hilarious. But yeah, it's been
that movie Okja that's on Netflix. Okja,
right? Okja? Whatever. Okja. Okja. Okja.
Yeah, that looked kind of. I might watch it, but I'm gonna have to have some tissues. I'm
interested in it at all.
I think
all.
That's gonna make me emotional. I don't know.
I saw the trailers and whatever, and I'm like, what the hell is this? I'm not interested.
It's about a kid who's raising an animal
It's meant for consumption.
I don't think the animal's meant for consumption.
Yes, it's meant for consumption. It was created for consumption.
To end
hunger.
How do you know? You haven't seen the movie.
Because I read about it. And that app you told me. Upflix.
Which one?
Upflix. The one that tells
that's
you about.
A cool app, right?
The one that tells you all the movies and shows showing up on Netflix. Yeah, I read it on that app.
Yeah, if you want to know what's coming on Netflix, Upflix, pretty good app. Especially if you're in the US. I don't know how it is if you're overseas. check it out anyway.
Yeah, check it out anyway. But yeah, I mean, it's been a heavy trailer week.
Yeah.
A heavy trailer week. Right? Different trailers because the trailer to Inhumans came out. Right. And you're interested, and I'm not.
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested, but not sold on it.
I'm not.
So I'll check it out.
I'm not even interested. Like, I'm not interested.
Why? What is it about it? It's right up your alley, more so than mine.
But because it didn't catch me. Like, it didn't ring me in. Right? Like, maybe the next trailer, maybe. But, like, I saw this one, and the only thing that impressed me was the fact that they kept the truth to the story that, you know, the royal family and some Inhumans lived on the moon, right? Because that's the way it is in the comics. Because I remember when they were bringing slowly, I was too slow with it, like rolling out Inhumans on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Right.
Like they had it like at some mountain retreat hidden away from like regular civilization. And that was the whole thing about joining civilization or whatever. Like, but they were hidden and nobody knew. And I'm like, no, that's not real. That's not the way it's supposed to be. So when I saw the trailer and it was, you know, the moon kingdom, right? The kingdom on the moon, whatever. And I said, okay, dope.
Yeah. But it seems
true to form.
But it seems though that the Inhumans from the Inhumans trailer, they were born with their powers, so they are who they are. Like,
right.
You know, whereas with the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.,
the Terrigen mist.
Yeah, these people lived normal lives until they got hit with the mist, and then they gained these powers.
Yeah, supposedly, it had like dormant inhuman genes, right? Like,
the X gene. It makes sense that they would, you know. But yeah, who knows? Whatever. All I know is Gotham, Flash, and Arrow is coming back.
And then the scene where he's getting beat up by the cops, and he just like that little grunt of pain, and you see like the police car flip over.
That was kind of
like,
cool.
That was for me. That was weak. Like Black Bolt, a whisper destroys worlds.
Yeah, but that would be the end of the show right there.
Exactly.
That would be the end of the show.
That's why he can't speak.
So you gotta rate it in a little bit.
But Lockjaw looked dope.
You want to have...
Right? Lockjaw looked dope, right? And I love, like, you know, he's this giant dog, but he was still like a puppy or whatever. Lockjaw was dope. Karnak was dope. Like, when he stomped on the ground and it, like a earthquake or a ripple effect. I thought that was dope. But, like, the trailer for me didn't pull me in. Like, it didn't do anything for me. So maybe I'll wait for another trailer, or I just won't watch the show.
Or just watch the first two episodes and then
we watch
like everything. You always watch two or three episodes.
We have so many shows.
Yeah, but a lot of them got canceled too. So
like which ones?
I can't remember now, but there's been a couple of shows that we
Supergirl, not canceled.
That we were
Flash, not canceled.
That we were getting into.
No, Green Arrow, not Flash, not canceled.
Different ones that we were getting into.
Legends, not canceled.
They got canceled.
All right, but talking about that, right? What about Black Lightning? Did we ever really discuss Black Lightning?
I don't think we did. I know you completely trashed it.
Yeah, I thought it was garbage.
I
thought was garbage. The only thing that intrigued me just a little bit was the daughter at the end, right? They showed like the lightning in her eyes. Like, oh, that's so cool. But I thought I think the suit is trash. I think the suit is like
what do you want to see in the suit?
I want to see something less rubbery. Right? Less like throwback to like bad 90s superhero shows. Like,
I don't know. I think the suit was riding along in lines with everyone else's on all the other DC shows.
No. This one looked more rubbery.
You know, because remember, all the costumes, they've done this with all their shows. Their costumes have all evolved. So.
Well, the Flash's costume didn't evolve that much. Only the future Flash. Like,
right.
Like, Emo Flash's costume was dope.
Right,
he should have brought that one back.
Which he's gonna have probably this coming season.
He should have taken that costume from him. It's like,
you
hey,
know, but they've all evolved.
I thought it was whack.
Well, I mean, you got to give it a chance though, because
it's
the same people that did Flash and
that's the only reason I'm gonna give it a chance, because I know that the writing is gonna be spectacular.
So the costume's a weak thing. Like, what about it other than the costume? That's kind of a weak thing to pick out.
The main thing that I didn't like, right, that it seems like a blaxploitation show in 2017.
How you figure?
Right. All we need is the boom.
So all we need is a dope soundtrack.
Why do you
say that?
Because the characters
are black.
It's a black character, right? A black, you know, black main character, and it's a problem with the ghetto and the problem with the black gangs and the problem with, you know, like that's not reality.
Okay, well, first of all, it's a superhero show.
So I know.
That's definitely not reality.
Dude. Yeah, I know, but still.
So you want him to be like in the suburbs where he's fighting white kids?
Why not? There are more drugs in the suburbs than there are in the projects.
Because that wouldn't, I mean, if I don't know. I think that if you're, I mean, so then Luke Cage was garbage because of that, because it was a black character in the ghetto fighting gangbangers. Except they were a little bit more sophisticated than just regular.
But there were different races. Like, it showed real. Like, one of like Shades was Boricua, right? It was different things, different races, different people. And well, in that 1-2 minute trailer,
Jay has completely. Decided what the show's about. You know, I mean. But remember though, but all they're saying is, they're not saying that that's you know, all they said that that's why he comes back, because they were having problems with these gangbangers. Remember, he's a teacher.
And then I'm kind of upset that it's supposedly not in the same universe.
That's the worst part.
Right? That's garbage.
That's
right?
The worst
part. That's the giant letdown.
It's like, come on, guys.
Right? That's a complete garbage. Like, you took Supergirl from CBS and brought it to the CW and tied it all together, but you're going to make Black Lightning
on the CW,
right? And bump out Legends, right, to have a night and whatever, and then like not even like put it all together. Come on.
Well, that's, you know what though, that's initially, right?
Come on.
I got a feeling they are going to connect.
Yeah.
It.
Yeah. If it becomes a hit, then they'll connect it. If it doesn't, then it gets canceled.
They'll just make it another Earth for Flash to go find.
Or maybe the same Earth.
Yeah, it could be. I think it could work.
Why not the same Earth? Because
he was retired, so no one would.
Right.
So no one would.
It's a whole different city, and then if he's had these powers, then it shows that they have been people with powers that has nothing to do with the
arc reactor.
The arc reactor accident, right? So
that would be. Yeah, I don't know. I saw the trailer. It was interesting. No problems with here's the thing. It makes sense. He's a teacher or he's a principal and, you know, at an urban school, and he's trying to make a difference with these kids, and they're having these problems. His daughters are starting to have problems with these gangbangers. So he kind of comes back because of that. I have no problem with that. That is not unrealistic. Now, if they make the show about him, as they unroll the show, as they expand the show, if it's basically just him fighting gangbangers, then that's the problem. Then you have a problem. But the idea that, I don't think there's any problem with the idea that he's a teacher, he cares about his kids, he cares about these kids, and gangs is a huge problem, you know, in urban America. So why wouldn't, if you could have the powers to fight them, to stop them, you would do that. Now it's how everything else unrolls after
right.
that.
So I have a question that just popped in my head.
What's your question? I have no answers.
Do you think, you don't know, because we don't know. But since the story behind Black Lightning is that he's a retired superhero, right? And he's forced to come back into whatever, forced out of retirement because of all the stuff that's happening going on, right? Do you think that they'll have mentions of like the Justice League or the Super Friends? Because every show,
they might. Because
every show has had some
right.
mention, some Easter egg, some something, right?
Right.
You think they'll do that in Black Lightning too? Because if he's retired,
they'll mention Static Shock,
right? I would love for them to do like a Static Shock show.
Seeing how they do their shows, you could easily see them doing a spinoff of that show of Static. You could see them spin off Static Shock off of Black Lightning.
Because remember, Static was in the Burbs, and his best friend was a white kid.
Right.
Right. But like, if anybody saw the Static Show cartoon, right, it was dope to watch. But they dealt with like heavy issues.
Yeah. So I mean, it could easily. They could easily spin that off, you know, like you get the nerdy kid, blah blah blah.
Maybe they'll turn his daughter into Static Shock.
Yeah,
the nerds will be in an uproar.
The nerds will be all mad,
right? Because
Static Shock is a guy, it's a boy. It's a boy. Is he though? Because he had that long hair. So sometimes you question that.
Well, why? It's 2017. We can't presume his identity. Anyway, wacky news time.
What was
right?
I gonna say? Completely lost.
Did you brain fart again?
Yeah, man. I had like something really kind of funny to say, but you kind of ruined it, man. Yeah. All right.
Maybe, all right. Wacky news. Maybe, wait.
Maybe it'll come back to me.
Back. Let's get back to. I saw today that there is a possibility that Catwoman may possibly be cast already, or they're heavily looking. You know how it happens in these new movie worlds where, right, people pay attention to, remember how we had the conversation about Twitter?
Right.
Right, how Twitter right now is like a big thing that when you see that people follow, certain people follow each other, that it could mean that that's what's going on. So anyway, actress, she's Latina, so I'm going to say that her name is Isa Gonzalez, right? She takes a picture on Instagram of herself in a cat suit, right? A black cat suit. Let me see if I can find a picture of it so I can show you. And,
okay.
Right? Which looks very similar to Catwoman.
Right.
Right? But the thing is that when I read it, you know, she takes that picture. It's talk about, like, whatever, practice, whatever, for a new role. Right? Very vague, like they do. But, like, she was followed by Jeff Johns, David Ayer, Margot Robbie. Right? This is Margot Robbie.
Right.
Right.
So either she could be cast or they're looking at her.
Or they're, yeah. Either okay. She's cast already and they haven't made the announcement, or like they're taking a look at her.
Did you see about Drake Bell?
Yeah, but he's doing that himself. He's doing a Tyrese.
Right, where he's been, well, but it's like he's really been, because not for the movie world, but for the Teen Titans show.
Well, they don't know which, if it's for the movie or the Teen Titans show, but yeah. He's basically pulling a Tyrese, right? He's like showing, doing all these, taking all these pictures and pictograms and all these videos and whatever, because he wants that role, so we'll see. But this chick just took a picture in the cat suit, but then all this other stuff happened in the background that didn't happen with Drake Bell, right? Like nobody's
that we know of yet.
That we know of, right? But the problem, right? Because there you go, Jay's finding a problem with everything. The problem is that
Catgirl is not Latina.
No, I don't care about that.
Oh, Catwoman.
The problem that I'm having is that if this is for Gotham City Sirens, right, which is a spinoff of Suicide Squad. Right, Suicide Squad is in the DCEU,
right?
Which would mean that Gotham City Sirens will also be in the DCEU. Right. This chick is like 27 years old, right? 25, 27 years old, right? And Catwoman, as we all know, is Batman's main love interest.
Unless, remember, they already established that since Batman's been doing this for so long, that they've lost people. So you could establish it where it's a new Catwoman. She's taken the mantle over for the original Catwoman that might have died or might have, I don't know, retired, gone away. Pick whatever route you want to go with her. So that way you get a younger Catwoman with a younger Harlequin.
Or
just Bruce, man.
Anna Nicole Smith version of Catwoman, right? You know, it's the young hot chick with the older billionaire.
I don't see that.
I still say that the chick from Once Upon a Time, La Boricua,
right?
That she'll be like, she'd be an awesome Catwoman.
Yeah, but I mean,
I've got nothing to do with casting. So,
but I'm thinking that's probably what it'll be. Like, you know, you'll establish like a younger Catwoman because you know that way you can
keep making movies.
You can make three or four movies with her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with Batman, so they're doing Justice League 2. The Batman movie that the director's talking about making it a noir Batman film.
Like a noir detective film.
Yeah, so that's like
kind of dumb. I love that he said almost like a first person perspective.
Right.
Right, where you get into the mind of Batman rather than just like an outside story and he's just fighting whatever.
Yeah, like we'll get to finally see the first person procedural. We'll be able to finally get to see the detective.
Yeah, that'll be ill.
You know, which we saw glimpses of in BVS.
Yes.
So that's awesome. So that was, yeah, man. So all that stuff is good. That's what I think. I, you know, I don't know. I'm excited. I'm, look, you know.
You can see Isa Gonzalez in Baby Driver. Because apparently she's in Baby Driver.
Oh, okay. And that comes out today or tomorrow. Today.
Oh, today.
Well, it's Friday. So.
Yeah.
We record these on Thursday night, which is merely means Friday morning.
No, we don't. We discuss them on Thursday night, and we don't start recording until early Friday morning. So, yes, it's today.
So we legit record on Friday.
We always say we're going to record Thursdays, but that never happens.
All right, so funny news of the day, like Jay was trying to
right,
say.
Right, right, right. Funny news.
So we're going to go funny news. Then we're going to go a song, and then we're going to dive into the topic because the topic jumps off of the video that we had seen earlier, right?
Nah, forget the video. Well, yeah. Okay, yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All right.
But we're not going to show the video.
No, we're not going to show the video, but we're going to talk about it. No, so I get this article pops up in one of my feeds.
How? I mean, you know what? Forget about it. I'm not even, forget about it.
I don't know. I have like two or three different feeds that just kind of like just show me like whatever. And this popped up and I saw this. I might have seen this on Reddit, actually. I can't remember. But the title is, Kenyan lawyer sues Israel over Jesus crucifixion. So, according to this article, this is, you know, according to the Kenya Daily, the lawyer's name is Indidis. He wants to use the Bible as evidence in his pursuit of justice over the death of Jesus Christ, who was killed by the Jews over 2,000 years ago, and he is confident of winning the case. So he, in March of this year, he filed a petition with the IJC, and he wants
not the ICJ.
No, IJC, and he wants Israel to be held responsible for the trial, crucifixion, and death of Jesus on the cross. Now, what's interesting is that, like, in his petition, in his legal suit, he also names Pontius Pilate, King Herod, and the Roman Emperor Tiberius, Italy, because that's, you know, where the Romans sprang out of, and a number of Jewish elders. So I thought it was
the most ridiculous thing I've ever read.
I don't know if it's the most ridiculous, but it was pretty freaking hilarious. Because especially he said, in this quote, he goes, I filed the case because it's my duty to uphold the dignity of Jesus. And I have gone to the ICJ to seek justice for the man from Nazareth.
Okay. I'm trying real hard, and that's why I let you say it all without interruption because I'm trying real hard not to just completely ridicule this guy because I think that maybe his heart is in the right place.
Yeah, I think his heart's in the right place.
Maybe, but.
Well, I don't know. I don't think there's a maybe to it. I think his heart is in the right place.
No, I say maybe because, you know, he might just be doing it for
publicity.
But
you know, I don't think though. I don't think so just because most people don't want to you would get that ridicule. That's not going to, you know, to get publicity, to maybe put your name out there, you're not going to do it. Like, this is a ridiculous way of doing it. Like, if he sued Boko Haram for kidnapping those girls, like, okay, that makes, yeah, like, that's how to get publicity, right? I'm going to sue them.
Right.
I'm
but apparently, he tried this in 2013.
Yes, and it got thrown
out. Right, and it got thrown, sorry, it got thrown out, right? And now he renewed his lawsuit. Now the thing is this, right? This is the funny thing, right? Because, like, what church is he going to, right? Who's his pastor, right? Who's what Bible is he reading?
I mean, he's reading the same Bible we are. Here's the thing: I'm willing to bet his pastor is like supporting him 100%.
Why?
Because that just sounds like something that just, I mean, to me, that just sounds like what it would be. Like, I think he'd be, you know, he came to his pastor, was like, hey, I'm going to, you know, go after these guys for what they did to Jesus. And it's, oh, that's a great idea. Because, and I'll say it, because it seems like lately we've been getting a lot of just kind of strange things coming out of Africa in general, the whole continent in general, where we, you know, I've seen videos of just outlandish things, like, you know, people getting punched for Jesus
and punched in the crotch
to so that they'll be fertile, and guys praying over people and telling them, reach into my pocket, and they pull out money and they're like, oh, God's blessed you because this money's overflowing out of my pocket.
Well, if you remember a couple of episodes ago, we talked about the Luciferian church, right, and how that pastor from Africa flew from Africa to, I don't remember where the church was, Texas, right. I think it was, right, to like to find this pastor, well, this Luciferian pastor, and feed him to the dogs.
Right.
Right? Because it's, what the, what? Like, yeah, what? So, wait, what?
So it's
an extreme, it's almost like there's an extreme militant perspective of,
yes,
of Jesus,
like even more extreme and militant than what people think here in the States.
Right,
right.
Like when think, it's almost like they say we're in the Lord's army. Like they weaponize.
Yeah, like when I say I'm in the Lord's army, I mean, like, you know, metaphorically speaking. When they say they're in the Lord's army, they're like dusting off their AK-47s, talking about we gonna get these bad people. Yeah. Which, listen, man, it you know, it's funny, but what's funny about this, though, what kind of came to my mind is how...
Yeah, Pontius Pilate, King Herod, and the Roman Emperor Tiberius.
And what's funny to me about this is that, I mean, this guy's not doing anything that a lot of Christians here in the States do or don't do. You know, his just is a more of an extreme case, but... you know, he's defending Jesus. He thinks he needs to get justice for Jesus. And how many people do we know, and how many times have we seen people, you know, make kind of those comments that they're going to get, you know, they got to stand up and end the persecution, and they got to stand up and, you know, not let the Lord be dot, 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 like fill in those blanks. Now, this guy's just doing it in a very, just doing it in a very extreme fashion. It's not going to go anywhere, but, you know, part of me says, kudos. Good luck, my friend. I hope you...
Part of me says, read your Bible. No, I'm sorry. All of me says, read your Bible.
You know, I want to think his heart is in a good place. He's just misguided. And, I mean, that happens.
If he's misguided, then his heart is misguided also.
It doesn't mean it's not in a good place.
All right, I'm gonna.
You could do dumb things... You know, you can have the right thought, you know, like the right motivation, and do dumb things.
I'm going to piggyback off of that.
All right.
Something that just caught my attention now in that same link you sent, that an Islamic scholar, Sheikh Husseini, Yusuf Mabera, Sheikh Husseini Yusuf Mabera has threatened to drag Prophet T.B. Joshua to the federal high court in Lagos State for saying Jesus Christ is God. Now, I have a question for you. Is this website like Africa News?
I'm assuming, because it did seem like everything was African related.
That would make sense.
Yeah, it says pulse.ng. I'm wondering if NG is for like Nigeria.
NG is for Nigeria.
So, yeah, but I mean, just, I don't know, that's not the right thing. But yeah, I mean, that's nothing. That's nothing new. That's not that shocking to me. You know, you had the government official in Jakarta that got sentenced to like 2 years in jail for blasphemy because he said that, you know, some people use the Quran to mislead,
right,
followers, and because he was a Christian, you know, they accused him of blasphemy, and I think he could have faced up to like 14 years, but they gave him two years.
So, how do you think this trial would like what would it look like? Like he's going to the International Justice Court. Right, or international.
Well, but it doesn't mean that they're gonna. They'll probably deny his petition. He just all he did was file a petition.
But I'm saying if they went through it, they said, "All right, you know what? Okay, we're gonna honor your petition. Right? Let's, you know, we're not gonna let you sue Italy. We're not gonna let you sue Israel. Right?
So then there's no trial.
But no, because he put in also, you know, you can sue Pontius Pilate. King Herod.
Yeah, that's not how the law would, that's not how the law would work, Jay. That's not how the law would work, Jay. Because those guys, if anything, they would throw those guys out, and they would let him sue the people that can actually defend.
So he's gonna sue the Pope.
No, he's not suing the Pope.
Why not sue the Pope?
Because the Pope is Christian. So he didn't. The Pope isn't the one that had Jesus crucified.
Well,
you can't even you're grasping for straws, my friend.
I'm sorry. I'm showing the ridiculousness of this guy who's also grasping for straws.
Hey, he's doing what he's doing, man. Don't be a hater.
Like, why would he sue Israel? Why would he sue Israel? Israel didn't crucify Jesus. The Romans did.
True, but they're the ones that dimed him out.
No snitching,
right? They dimed him out. Maybe he lives by a no snitch code. You know, they dimed Jesus out.
No snitching.
You know, they said, "Hey, you don't kill him."
What he needs to do is find the
descendants of Barabbas. You know, you don't kill him.
Find the descendants of Barabbas.
Barabbas then, probably didn't have any descendants, bro. That dude got let go, and he probably he got killed like a week later.
as soon as he got let out.
You know, he tried to start another fight with some Romans. Yeah, that dude. I don't know. I just thought it was a funny article. I just thought it was very interesting.
Well, it's definitely a funny article.
I just thought it was interesting. I thought, you know, that's.
It keeps making me laugh.
You know, the fact that somebody would.
That's
would
the joke think, that keeps on giving.
Would think that that's. Would think that that's.
Like, did he pray about this? Did he pray about this? Did he ask guidance from the Holy
Spirit?
Maybe
he's
about
not
this?
Even a Christian. Maybe a pastor that's unnamed is the one that hired him to file this petition.
Did that pastor pray about this?
Like I said, man, we've seen some crazy things. We've seen some crazy things come out of Africa lately.
Anyway.
So it doesn't matter. But once again, I will make the argument, and others could probably make it better, that, I mean, what he's doing is outlandish and looks outlandish.
And outrageous.
But, I mean, people do that here, too. People do that kind of stuff here, too. Maybe not go to court, but they feel like they've got to do things to, you know.
Which will lead us into our topic.
Stand up for God.
Which will lead us into our topic after a word from our sponsor.
Who's our sponsor?
Our sponsor is just like every other week for the last 2 weeks.
Us. I finance this thing.
Jay and Joaquin. Right, but you know, it's song time. And although Joaquin is not as excited as he was, I'm getting more excited.
See, now
the closer we get to today.
Like, on the drive down, I'll be like, yee!
Right? Like the closer we get. It's funny, right? Because I forget. Right, so busy with work and other stuff and church and other things that I forget. But then at work, someone asked me today, "Hey, so like you're leaving for your cruise in just like a couple of days, right? A little over a week." And I'm like, "No, it's it. Oh crap, yeah, it is just a little over a week. Yeah, it's gonna be a lot of fangirling on that cruise.
Nah,
and not just by us." By other 40-year-olds.
But mostly by Jay. I'm done with fangirling. I'm done with it. I retired.
No, you did it.
Yes.
No, you did it. So you're not bringing your covers?
I am, but that's not being a fangirl.
That's being a fangirl.
Nah.
Your fangirl is...
Nah.
You're gonna see.
I don't think you understand the definition.
I'm gonna put up a picture of Joaquin with the autographs of each member of DC Talk on his head.
Actually, be on my chest
in Sharpie. I was trying not to go there, but anyway,
I'll go there.
Anyway, we've done the title track of their last four albums.
Yes, today is Jesus.
Right? So today is
the Jesus Freak album.
And the song is
Jesus Freak.
Jesus Freak. So man,
listen, nothing else needs to be said.
Word up. Give it a listen.
What will people think when they hear that I'm a Jesus?
was it.
Dude, I like that last riff at the end.
Well, dude, you know what? You didn't get it.
You suck, man. You took away the ending.
So, that was Jesus Freak by DC Talk off of their album Jesus Freak.
That's the album that changed the game for them.
Yeah.
For them. That's where they changed their sound.
Yeah.
You know, they did more singing, more rock, less hip hop.
Well, I think that's just the album where they did more of what they wanted to do. You know,
it showed evolution, right? A lot of artists get stuck in, right, in a sound.
And not only did
growing.
It show evolution, but people liked it. Because you know how it is, like, artists will put out an album, everybody likes it. Then when they put out another one and it's completely different or changes, and people tend to,
we like the old sound. We like the old way of doing it.
I know someone who hated it.
Right.
That's how I got that CD. Because he came to me and said, did you listen to the new DC Talk album? It's like, nah, not yet. I haven't bought it yet. I'm gonna go after work today.
Oh, you can have mine. They changed their sound completely. I didn't like it.
And I was like, oh, dope. You just saved me $20. Yay.
Wow. CDs used to be $20.
And then when I got home and I threw it on, forget about it. It was freaking awesome. It's still awesome.
Yeah.
So
it's a great album. It's aged well.
I don't know where he is, pero Edwin. Edwin?
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
muchas gracias. All right, so now let's just dive into today's little
you know what we have learned
topic or whatever. So Jay,
today.
God has all right, what we got going on for today?
In his book, you see, we know that God. Okay, so the deal is, right, this morning. It was this morning, right, when I sent that to you, when I tagged you on that?
Yes.
This morning, I saw a video about certain pastors, and I'm going to say certain pastors and not say their names or the names of their churches, not to defend them or protect them or whatever. It's only because on the video, they didn't show their names, right, or the names of their churches. So I can't give them to you. If they did, I probably would have, probably. But certain pastors of certain denominations that said that they've been doing church wrong or preaching wrong or whatever because they've accepted the whole idea of homosexuality just being a part of everyday life and you're born that way and created whatever, whatever, whatever. We're not going to talk about that. What we're going to talk about is the responses and the reactions that this video drew from believers, where it was borderline hate mongering almost, right? And then one of the things that was stated was the whole, you know, we're supposed to love the sinner but hate the sin, right? And
right,
you know, Joaquin and I, we started unpacking that. What does that mean? What that means, because the both of us do not agree with that statement, right? Now, we're not saying that the statement is wrong. Right. We're just saying
we've evolved.
That we feel that it's not only
we're capable of that.
Not only is it used too much, right? And I think that it's used too much as a crutch to defend
bad behavior
and bad thoughts and bad actions, but also that it's used out of context, right? And it's used wrong.
Right, and it's used as a point of pride for some people. Even, you know,
right,
like,
so,
oh, I'm supposed to, well, but I only hate the sin, so that allows me to treat people.
Right.
Oh.
Whoever that guy is.
Whoever that guy is, right? But the thing is that, right, so we started, like, we asked ourselves, like, where did that come from? You know, where did that statement that so many people have used, I know that I myself have used it.
Yeah, all of us have. Right? If we're honest, all of us have used it at some point.
But like, where did it come from? And why do we use it so often, right? And we only use it when we want to attack a certain sin that we personally, deeply don't agree with,
right?
Because it's not, we don't say that for everything. Oh man, you lie to your mom. Well, I got to hate the sin and not the sinner, right? The sinner, right? It's only like these extreme things, sexual sins, whatever falls right. under the category or the umbrella of sexual sin, right? And like drugs or whatever, so whatever's extreme, right? And like we know that for God, there is no sin greater than the other, right? Right? For God, it's blanket. Sin is sin. But for us, when we take it personally, right, when it's something that we deeply hate, right, because we hate the sin and not the sinner. So when it comes to something we deeply hate or we deeply disagree with right. personally, right, then we use that term or we use that cliche, let's say, you know, hate the sin and not the sinner as an excuse to like attack people, right, to like and we convince ourselves that we're doing it, you know, out of love because we're trying to get this person saved. But if you're attacking,
right,
right, that's not going to convince right. anybody that attacking that God
or,
is
or
love.
Or even as a way of I don't want to say shunning because that's not the right word, but as a way to keep people at, away or at arm's length, right? Well, I can't have you around because you're committing this sin, and then it's like, what? But why? It's like, well, hey, man, I love you, but I hate the sin. Can't have that sin around me.
Right. And you know? How, right, if we are told, right, and we and these are things that we repeat a lot on Outcry, right, on the Overflow Podcast. If we are told, if Scripture tells us that people will know that we're disciples of Jesus by the way we love one another, but then we go and attack people, and we justify it by saying, well, I'm supposed to hate the sin and not the sinner, then you're not showing yourself as a disciple of Christ by shunning people because of their sin.
Right. If you, right? Right. If you say that, but your act... So it's like if you say, I love the person, not, but I hate the sin, but you carry that thought out in an unloving manner.
Right.
Regardless of how... Yeah, whatever that looks like, right?
And you speak to them unlovingly.
But it's in an unloving manner, you're failing.
You shun them, you reject them, right? You don't try to create relationship with them
right.
so that they can see
the,
right,
love of God.
The love of God in you, right? And that is what's going to break through all things, right? Break through all sin, break through all walls, all veils, all thought processes, right? It's you showing them the love of God, right? Now, what Joaquin and I were talking about earlier is that, you know, it's hard to distinguish, right? It's hard to distinguish for you to be able to say you hate the sin and not the sinner. It's hard really to distinguish that because the sin is the sinner.
Right.
And it's
in the sinner.
Right? It's in the sinner and it's. It envelops them, and that's how they identify themselves, right? That's how we identify them, right? If I'm an alcoholic, right, you don't say that I'm a man that has a drinking problem. You know, you're an alcoholic, right? I get drunk. I'm a drunkard, right? And the sin is in getting drunk. So you're going to tell me you hate the sin and not the sinner, but I am the sin. I'm a drunkard. I'm an alcoholic. Right. So you it doesn't matter how you try to justify or how you try to paint the picture. You're going to tell me you hate the sin and not the sinner. The sin is drunkenness. I'm a drunkard. You hate me. Right. The way you treat me shows hatred. The way you reject me shows hatred. Right. There's nothing about that that brings me closer to you or makes me even want to know who this God of hatred is. This God, if you're, as we say here, an ambassador of Christ and you reflect Christ and you show who God is and all you do is reject me, all you do is condemn me and judge me, then that to me shows me that your God is condemning, is judgmental, and is also going to reject me because of this weakness that I right. have that is my sin.
Right. It's like I had somebody tell me, well, my sister told me one time, she said, I would rather, she goes, you know, all those Christians, you know, at such and such a place, there were a bunch of hypocrites because of how they, well, why did she say that? Because of how, you know, the things they said or how they acted or how they rejected or people. And so she wants nothing to do, you know, with Christians. And even with things like, you know, my sister's a millennial, so she's way more open about, you know, a lot of these kind of social issues now, you know, homosexuality and drugs and all these different kind of things. And her response is always, you know, well, you know, I can't believe, you know, why do they have to be so harsh, or why do they have to be so judgmental or so mean? It's not affecting their life, right? It doesn't, you know, it doesn't change how they live their life, you know. And she's right to an extent,
to a certain degree,
right?
She is,
you know, she, you're right. You know, listen, if you want to, you know, if your thing is, you know, you're homosexual and that's my lifestyle I'm living, or if you're like, hey, I want to, you know, I want to be a drunkard and that's the life I'm going to live, you know, as long as, you know, the reality is that doesn't affect me until you do something that comes into my sphere. So you being a drunkard, that's what you want to do. Okay. Doesn't affect me until you hit me with your car because you're driving drunk, right? Or until you kill
my dog, let's say,
you know, my family member or whatever. So there is, that's just the truth. That's
correct.
That's just reality, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, sin is not a corporate thing.
Right.
Sin is a personal thing. But we always kind of have this, like, we always want to make it into like this corporate kind of thing where Jay's sin does not affect me. My sins do not affect Jay. Now, my sins affect Jay if my sins affect the ministry.
Mm-hmm.
So, right. So if we were getting money, right, for this podcast, and I'm using the money to buy cocaine, then that sin.
Then those are two problems.
Right. So I'm stealing the money and I'm using cocaine. That sin no longer just affects me. It also affects Jay. But if we're getting paid and we're splitting it 50-50 and I'm doing bumps at home, you know, that doesn't affect Jay. Right? So we gotta, I think part of the problem is that we seem to view sin as kind of this very corporate,
mm-hmm.
you know,
and then we also get to this point, I guess, that we I've touched on this a lot in my times as an evangelist going around and preaching and speaking the word. We sometimes we get to this degree in our Christianity, let's say, right? And where we forget that not only are we redeemed sinners, but we still sin and fall right. short from the glory of God, right? So it's almost like God has become so familiar. He's become so familiar that we forget that, you know, we sin and we have to seek repentance and we have to be redeemed and we have to be, you know, we have to come back into repentance, right? Because again, as I said earlier, like sin is sin. Right. So we see other people's sins and we judge them as worse than ours, as greater right. than ours. So we get like haughty
yeah,
in our Christianity
right.
and we feel that we are allowed to like point the finger and say, well, you can and you shouldn't right. and you shouldn't, you shouldn't, you shouldn't. And we judge and we forget that Jesus tells us, you know, before you judge your brother for the toothpick in his eye, right? Remember that you have a tree growing out of yours,
right?
Right? Which is like brilliant in its perspective. But, you know, there and again, it's a thing that is said a lot and a lot and a lot. And we forget that we are not, like Jesus did not call us to judge others outside of the church. I have to make that distinction.
Right. There is a distinction. Yes.
Right. He didn't call us to judge others outside of the church. He called us to go out and make disciples, right? Baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching everything that he has taught us, right? He called us to love your neighbor as you love yourself. He commands us to love everyone as he loves us. Because that's how we'll know, that's how they'll know that we're his disciples and how we love one another, right? Right? So all of these things, right? And I'm not, okay, wait, we're not saying that that's a bad thought process, right? Because like we went through scripture and we found that in that the foundation of that, or the idea of that, though misinterpreted, right, is found in Jude. I'm going to just say Jude because it's only one chapter, so you don't have to look around for chapters, right? But in Jude, verses 22 and 23, it reads, "And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh," right? So yes, right? But it's not a hatred, right? It's not a hatred where you strike your brother, where you strike the sinner, where you like condemn them, right? Or reject them, right? Because if we are to follow the example of Christ, I think two or three episodes ago, sometimes I get confused between episodes and Sunday sermons. But you know, we spoke about that Jesus, oh no, it was a Sunday sermon. It was a Sunday sermon, right? Where Jesus, when he called out Levi, right? He called out Levi, and Levi left everything. Levi was a tax collector, so he was seen by the Hebrews as one of the worst, that is the worst of sinners, because he was a tax collector.
Traitor.
Right? And Levi, Jesus called out Levi, who was later known as Matthew, and Levi threw a party, invited all his friends, other tax collectors and other sinners, and Jesus was there amongst them, right? So, and he didn't sit and condemn them, right? He didn't say, "Well, I'm gonna sit with you, right? Because I love you, but I hate everything that you're doing. I hate everything that you're all about, right? But I'm gonna sit here because I'm hungry and I'm gonna eat," right? Right. Like, he sat with them and he partied with them. He partook with them, and Jesus was in turn condemned and judged by the Pharisees and the scribes that saw him, like, I guess, cavorting and hanging out with, they even said it, you know, if you say that, you know, that you believe in God or whatever, then what are you doing sitting down with sinners and tax collectors, right? Right. Right? They did to him, they did to Jesus what you who say and stand proudly behind that statement of love the sinner but hate the sin, what you're doing.
Right. And the thing is that, you know, how can you love, you know, and I think this is a great way of thinking it, because I'm saying it. How can you love the sinner and hate the sin when you won't even spend any time with the sinner? Mm. Right? You can't say I'm standing against that sin because I love the sinner and I hate the sin, but you don't break bread with the sinner. You don't do life with the sinner. You can't love. It's like saying I love my wife, but she lives in her own house and I live in mine. You know?
Wow. That's dope.
Right? That's stupid. I'll say it is stupid. Just because you hang with the sinner, it doesn't mean that you tolerate, right, the sin, the sin or sins that the sinner's engaged in. But he can't know, right? He can't know if you're not there. And I think I say this for me and Jay, because we both grew up hearing this term. But then when we're honest and as we were talking and when we thought back, right, when we think back to, you know, all the times we've heard that statement, the sinner was never there.
Yeah, correct.
You know, it wasn't like I love the sinner, so I'm gonna go to Applebee's and have some those riblets and have some riblets with them and just break bread. No, it's we can't be around them because they're sinners. I love the sinner, but I hate their sin, and we can't be around it.
Oh, we can't. Yeah, we have to isolate ourselves. We gotta reject them. We gotta, you know, we can't hang out with them. You can't hang out with people that aren't Christians.
Right.
Right. And you, I'll be honest with you, that was one of the first things that got me in trouble in church growing up. Well, you should cut off all ties with non-believers and don't hang out and you don't have friends that aren't Christians. And my question was, well, then how can I tell them about Jesus? Right? How can I tell?
Right, because there's a difference between cutting ties in the sense of not being involved. I mean, look, right. I mean, the reality is, right, that when we come to Christ and as people come to Christ, sometimes there are people we got to just completely cut out of our lives because they're, you know, they're toxic.
Correct.
Right. And then it's not as a new believer, as a young believer, you're not mature enough or strong enough to handle being around those people. But generally speaking, right, what loving the sinner and not agreeing with the sin, right, what kind of where that plays, that where that falls into play, you know, is things like, you know, Jay's the sinner, and I go hang out with Jay. We go out to eat. We go to the pizza place. We go to the Lepardo's, our favorite pizza place, and we have a couple of slices, and we hang out, and we talk. But then Jay's like, "Yo, I'm gonna go." always the example. I'm gonna go to the strip club. I'm going to go to the strip club. You want to come with me? Man, that's not right. You don't need to be going to the strip club. You know, that's not a good look. Whatever. However that conversation goes, and then you just part ways, right? Because you can't tolerate that. You can't show them, you know, because that's really what tolerating it is, right? It's just, you know, even if you just sit in the corner, but you went with them, so you're part of it. And that's what gets a lot of us Christians in trouble, right? There's that kind of duality to it where you're like, you know, some people are like, hate the sin, you know, hate the sinner, hate the sin, or love the sinner, hate the sin. And you completely cut ties and you never spend any time with this person so that you can show them the love of God. But then the extreme to that is, you know, love the sinner, tolerate the sin. So I'm going to go sit with you in the dirt you do. I'm not going to do it, but I'm going to sit with you. Right? Because I'm going to show you that I love you. I'm going to show you that we're cool.
But then you never talk about Christ.
But then you never talk about Jesus with them. You know, so it's, you know, so don't misunderstand, right? Don't think that, oh, okay, so that means that I can just hang out with that person and it's okay. Well, no, you can hang out with that person, but you have to be wise in knowing when you have to tell them, yo, peace out. I'll see you tomorrow.
Now, I when we were discussing this before, you were talking about you gave an example about the dude in Chicago.
The dude in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
The band Chicago or the city?
The city, dude. The city. Wah, wah, wah.
Oh, yeah. So I remember. Yeah,
share that.
Yeah, I remember way back in the day. And I'm going to have to look it up because I remember reading this book by Philip Yancey where he talked about a friend of his in Chicago, because I believe Philip Yancey's in Chicago, or was at the time. Anyway, so he was talking about his friend of his in Chicago who, you know, was a Christian, and he was involved as part of his ministry. But don't quote me on that. Like I said, I have to go look it up and refresh my memory on it. But the guy dealt a lot with the homosexual community in Chicago. And what Yancey was saying in his book, because the book was a book about grace that he wrote, he was saying that this guy was like living. He was an example of what living in grace looks like, because you know he did things with this group of people and his organizations and different things, but they all knew his stance as a Christian on homosexuality. They knew he didn't support it. They knew that he thought it was a sin before God. Like for real, it was like just boom, like that. But he still, they would call him, you know, if they had issues, a problem, they would call him. He would go and have lunch with them. I mean, he was heavily involved in helping them, not just for an ulterior motive. And I want to say that it was during the 80s when like the whole HIV stuff was really popping off in the gay community, you know, where it was like just a real epidemic. And he was there. And I think to me that stuck with me, right? That has always stuck with me, because to me that is the example that we need to on how we need to approach loving the sinner and hating the sin.
Right. So
like how that was a great example of how that plays itself. He spent time with them. He broke bread with them. He helped them community.
And I think that.
And they still knew he was a Christian that didn't agree with their lifestyle.
And I think that we discussed this. That's why I wanted you to say that anecdote, because the best way that we as believers can show people that we love the sinner but hate the sin, right, is to continue pouring love into that person,
right?
In spite of what their life is, in spite of what their lifestyle choice is, in spite of what they do or how they think or what they say or how they act, right? You continue engaging with that person or with those people, right? You build them up, right? You pour into them,
right? In a genuine way, without motive,
right?
Right, because that's important, right? Because some people would take that and go, oh yeah, so I'm going to do this so that I can get them saved. Yeah, well, no. You do this because you love them.
Exactly, because we don't save anybody, right? We are not.
Unless they fall in the lake and you swim and you pull them out, that's the only way you're going to save somebody.
Right, or you don't swim and you call 911. But we are not substitutes for the Holy Spirit. We're not.
Right.
We're not. Right, we're messengers, we're farmers, basically, right? And you hate sin, right? You hate sin, and you show your hatred for sin by combating it with grace.
Yes.
Right? Your weapon against sin is grace. You show grace. You show love, right? No matter what. You don't agree with it? Don't agree with it. You don't have to agree with it.
Right.
But you don't fight it, right? You're not combative. Right, you're not condemning, right? Because none of those things is going to bring the unbeliever to a recognition or an acknowledgement of Christ to then be redeemed and like saved from their sin or whatever sin it is. Right? None of those things are going to draw people unto Him.
Right? Because getting somebody to stop doing that, their sin, whatever the sin is, right? Quotation marks, whatever the sin is. Just because you convince them to stop doing that sin, but there is no regeneration of the heart.
That's called rehab.
Right? Then that person, even if they never do that sin again, right? You still didn't lead them.
You didn't lead them to Christ. There's no reconciliation. There's no renewal.
Right? So, you know,
no repentance.
I think that what we need to do is, or it seems to me that the proper step is, let's share Christ with these people, with these folks, through our life, through our interaction, through our. I mean, listen, we all can usually find something in common with someone, right? Whether it's love for movies, I love movies too. You like movies too? Awesome. Let's go. Hey, this movie, Baby Driver, is coming out. Let's go watch it. And so you engaged in life through that shared
interest.
That's how you do it. Not by saying, well, you need to stop doing this or you need to stop doing that.
Or I can't.
You know, I can't hang be with you because. You know, I know that after we leave the movies, you're going to go like snort 10 pounds of cocaine and I can't be around that's like that.
Suicide.
Right. Maybe they're really big. Like Andre the Giant size.
It's still suicide.
So what did you just do? Did you do anything to lead them to Christ? No, all you did was you just rejected them.
Yeah.
You know,
and that translates that translates to them that if you, as a representative of Christ, reject them for their sin, then Jesus will also reject them for their sins.
Right. So the tactic is, let me love, build relationship. In the midst of that, through the prompting of the Holy Spirit, you share the gospel, you share Christ. Because our concern as believers should be the soul, not the physical. Do you understand what I'm saying? Our concern is the soul. We want their soul to reconnect with their creator. Because if our flesh dies away and passes away, well, guess what? You know, sin, if sin is just at its most basic, us wanting to fulfill the flesh, right? The flesh passes away at some point when you die. The worms eat it, right?
Correct.
But our soul is what goes before God. That should be our concern. Not getting them to stop their sin or what it is that we perceive their sin to be. Get them to know Christ. Help them grow in Christ. And you let the Holy Spirit and God work.
Right. Let the Holy Spirit work through you, right? Because that's the thing, right? The Holy Spirit draws people to Christ and draws people to repentance, right? We are the messengers. Right, we are the farmers. We plant the seeds of revelation. We plant the seeds of reconciliation, of redemption, of renewal, right? By showing them God's love, right? Because again, it's one of his commandments. They will know that you're my disciples by the way you love one another,
right?
Right? Love your neighbor as you love yourself, right? And let the Holy Spirit do the work, right? I'm not saying, you know, go and be their buddy, right? And just hang out with them and act like nothing. No. You know, let them know, you know, it's like, you know, the way you know what their sin is, then they need to know who your God is, right? And, you know, let the Holy Spirit do the rest. You build relationships, you build community, right? You connect with them, right? And they'll see the love of Christ,
right,
through you and how you work, right, with them, right? Again, you combat it, right? You're combative, right? But instead of with condemnation, you combat it with grace and with love.
And with mercy.
And with mercy.
And with shared interests. You know, you know what I'm saying? Like you do the things that you have in common.
Right. And in those things, you show the fruits of the Spirit.
You know? And in those things, right, you should be showing in those things, they should know that, A, there's something quite different about you. Because, you know, listen, people get told about their sins
every day,
right? And I've shared this before. I think, you know, one time I hung out with this kid, and he, the greatest compliment I've ever gotten as a believer. He says, "Man," he goes, "Man, I like hanging out with you, man. You're not like all these other Christians. You know why?" And I'm like, "Huh? Well, thanks. Okay." You know, like I'm thinking, you know, he goes, "Oh no, man, like." I've hung out, and the whole time all they're doing is just Jesus this, Jesus that, just trying to shove this thing in my face. And you were just hanging. We were just hanging out, right? It was because I had no motive. There was no ulterior motive for me.
Right.
I just wanted to get to know this kid.
This genuine relationship.
We hung out. We went to the mall. We goofed around, whatever. He knew who I was. He knew where I went to church. He knew who the people I knew. I didn't need to tell him those things. Right, he'd heard about Jesus, but you know what he hadn't done? He hadn't hung around a Christian that just had fun with him for him.
Right,
and I think that a lot of times people know you're a Christian, right? Or they know you try to be one.
In my case,
they know you try to be one.
Right? They've heard that you're a Christian, but they haven't seen.
Experience. A lot of people's experiences with Christians are, especially, let's just anywhere. Let's just say, you know, in the South, it seems, because we're in the South, it just seems like, especially in the South, but the experience is, you know, he's trying to, or she's trying to convert me.
Or they are condemning me.
Right. Or, you know, they're trying to convert me because they condemn me. Or they're condemning me because they're trying to, you know, however that thought process works in these people's heads. But I guarantee you a lot of them haven't had someone that was just genuinely interested in who they are.
Right. Like a genuine interest and a genuine connection.
Even if you disagree. You know, it's a hard thing because we want to be right and we want to be like good Christians, right? We want to kind of whatever that means, right? But even if this is a hard one because it started with the even if it means you sitting there and just and Jay might, you know, disagree with me wholeheartedly on this one, but even if you just sit in there and let's say you're sitting with this gay person and they're just telling you about their relationship and their struggles with their relationship with their significant other. Even if it's just sitting there and just listening to them, maybe giving them advice,
I don't disagree with that. I've done that.
I said maybe.
Yeah, no, I'm letting you know, I've done that.
You know, and just saying, well, you know what, man, relationships are tough. You know, mm-hmm. Go buy them flowers. I don't know, whatever the situation might be. But it's not that you're just sitting there going, whoa, you see, you're having problems because you're with somebody that's
you're having problems because you're with a, because you're of your sin and because sin, you're blah, yeah. Blah,
blah, blah. Nah. No. You're having problems because relationships have problems.
I mean, one of
you know, and I think that if we approach it in kind of that manner where they don't, once again, it doesn't mean that you agree.
Right.
You don't have to agree to offer good advice.
Correct.
Right? But it just means that you're saying, look, I'm here for you. Because the reality is, as you develop that relationship, a lot of these conversations, they come up.
Uh-huh. They do.
And they'll come up.
On their own.
You know?
Right? Because there's
and you'll be able to have them out of a place of friendship instead mm-hmm. of out of a place of antagonism.
It's as you said with that one kid, right? He told you that. Because it shocked him, right? He was curious as to why you were different from all the other Christians that he's come across, right? And that happens. Like, there is a curiosity. If I've been condemned by every other person who has said they're Christian, and you, like, you have, like, genuine friendship with me, right? Because I'm not going to mention, but somebody that, you know, somebody that I work with that you know,
right?
Who's gay, and, right? Boyfriend or husband or partner was like, mom just died, and he came to me, right? Because it happened like after Poppy died, and like he was like, oh, I'm just, you know, I just got to be there for him, you know. And like, dude, like, I'm yeah, I get it, it's hard, you know, I just lost my dad, it's rough, blah blah blah, whatever. And then like he told me, it's like, you know what, in all our years of friendship, right, I never thought that I'd have such a close friend, right, who's a Christian,
right,
who's a Christian, and, you know, who's a minister, right, and who has never condemned me, right? And
to
I'm
your
like,
face.
Right, it's like he was like he has never condemned me. Like, you've never condemned me. Like, I'm not gonna condemn you. Your sins aren't worse than mine. Like, they're not worse than mine.
Just a little bit,
right? It's like,
not much.
Your sins aren't worse than mine. Like, we all sin, right? God loves us all. Jesus died for you, and he died for me. Right,
because what does it mean at the end of the day, you know, which
wait, I'm sorry, I have to put in there, that doesn't mean that I agreed with his lifestyle,
right,
or that I glossed over it because, you know, everything is awesome, right? But it did, and it does still to this day, like, gives him a certain level of comfort in knowing that I can come to him and I can talk to him about Jesus. I can talk to him about God. And I've done it, and I do. We don't work together anymore. But, and he won't, like, he doesn't feel attacked.
Right.
Right? He doesn't feel condemned.
Right, because you're concerned. See, and once again, that's, like I said earlier, I can reiterate.
It's a soul issue.
Because I'm thinking about it. Yeah, it's just, our concern should be the soul, not the sin. The sin is of the flesh.
Right.
Right? So the flesh passes away. Like, so I read a couple of books before I got in by Henry Nguyen, who was a priest, and he ended up moving to Canada, and he spent, I believe he's passed away now, there's been years now, but he spent like 15, 20 years. His service to God was taking care of this kid that was invalid, right?
Well.
And it turns out that this guy's, you know, dealt with homosexuality. And so he kind of removed himself and he just focused himself on God in service, right? As a way to connect with God. And I say that to just kind of as an example, because you know what? See, for him, that was of the flesh, right? So he had to, as a believer, he had to tame that or try to tame that. But ultimately, it's about the soul and it's about our connection with God. All the other stuff, all the flesh stuff, gets handled as we grow genuinely in our relationship with Him.
Right.
You know, you hear all the time, I accepted the Lord, I grew in faith, I stopped drinking, I stopped doing this, I stopped doing that. It wasn't, but they did it not because they were told to stop doing it and condemned to do it, but because they grew in faith. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, they were able to stop doing it.
And through the what?
Power of the Holy Spirit.
Through the power of the Holy Spirit.
So
it's the Holy Spirit's job to convict and to renew and to redeem.
I think that's it.
Yeah, that is it. That's exactly it.
That's where we end. I think there's nothing else to say.
No, I'm agreeing. I'm saying that's exactly it.
So you got to say that. You just don't repeat me. Me and Jay are going to get into a fight after this is over. So listen, guys. Hopefully you followed us with this conversation. Hopefully it'll give you something to think about. I know it's something that me and Jay will continually wrestle with and talk about as we try to, just grow in this and try to understand how we can be better ambassadors.
Because it's easy to fall back to that, right? That's almost like a default. It's easy to fall back to that. But we have to, as you just said, like we have to grow in that daily.
And continue to do that. So with that being said, as Jay's catchphrase is right, like the seagulls.
It's not a catchphrase, it's just a word.
His crutch. right. And mine is that being said. That's it, we're done. Thank you for joining us as always. Don't forget, you can just go to thisisoutcry.com. From there, you can link up to iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, or just SoundCloud right then and there. And guys, we'll talk to you guys next week. As always, leave us any messages. Tell us you like us. Tell us you hate us. Tell us you're indifferent. And we will, Lord willing, talk to you next week. As we get ready to go on our cruise,
it'll be supernatural.
This is Jay.
No.
I mean, this is Joaquin.
And I'm Jay.
And this is the Overflow Podcast. This is Outcry.
Thanks for listening. Remember to head on over to thisisoutcry.com for more content. And don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, Google Play, SoundCloud, or Stitcher.